So hi guys and a very good morning to all of you. Welcome back once again to the session of PIB 247. Main hu Manish Mishra and guys, in today's session, as usually, we are going to discuss some more questions from the PIB news. And in today's session, guys, we are going to discuss two questions from the static part as well. Okay, so let's begin with the session. But before we begin, if you are new here, do subscribe to our channel and press this bell icon taki aapko videos ki notification mil sake. So let's begin with the very first question, which says, which of the following digital platform has been launched by Dr. Harshvardhan, who is the Minister for Science and Technology, for ocean data management, which will provide all the information about ocean to the stakeholders? So this digital platform is named as what? Digital Ocean. Okay, the name of this digital platform is what? Digital Ocean, and it has been developed by INCOIS. And what is this INCOIS? INCOIS, International Center for Ocean Information Services. So you should remember, guys, that this digital platform, Digital Ocean, has been developed by INCOIS, or we can say International Center for Ocean Information Services. All right. And as the question says, it was released by Dr. Harshvardhan. And now, for what purpose this digital platform has been launched? So it has been launched, guys, for the ocean data management. Jo bhi ocean ka data hai, usko manage karne ke liye, and to provide all the information, all the knowledge about the ocean to all the stakeholders. And who are the stakeholders? These are, for example, we have research institutions, we have policy makers, etc. Okay, so this is the basic purpose of establishing this digital platform. So it will help to share the knowledge about the ocean with a wide range of stakeholders, like we have research institutions, operational agencies, strategic users, etc. And guys, it will also provide free access of information to the general public and common man as well. Okay. So here in this question, you have to remember two important things: the name of the digital platform, and it has been developed by INCOIS. And for what purpose? For ocean data management, and to provide information about the ocean to all the stakeholders. All right. So therefore, option C, Digital Ocean, is the correct answer. And now let's move on to question number two. Recently, a report titled Action Agenda for Atmanirbharta, which in short is AAN, has been launched by the Minister of Science and Technology, who is again Dr. Harshvardhan. He is also the Minister of Earth Sciences and the Minister of Health and Family Welfare. This report is a follow-up of IFFAC's white paper on focused interventions for Make in India post-COVID. This white paper, guys, was released this year in the month of July. Okay, July 2020 mein white paper release hua tha. Make in India post-COVID ke liye kya kya focused interventions hone chahiye, aur isme 5 sectors ki baat ki gayi thi. So the question is, which of the following sectors is not one of the focused sector in the TFACS white paper that was released in the month of July 2020? Now, there are two different things, guys. There is one TFACS white paper, okay, and there is one action agenda for Atmanirbharta. So what is this action agenda for Atmanirbharta? This is, guys, basically a follow-up. This is a follow-up of this TFACS white paper. Jo TFACS ka white paper release hua tha, jisme focused interventions की बात की गई थी, उसके follow-up देने के लिए एक report launch की है Ministry of Science and Technology ने. Okay, and you don't have to go in detail about this report, that is not required for the exam. Just remember, there is one report that has been launched to follow up the TFACS white paper for focused interventions in Make in India post COVID. ठीक है, and of course you have to remember the name of the report, Action Agenda for Atmanirbharta. Okay. And talking about the basic aim is to create a sense of scientific social responsibility among the citizen. Aisa jo hamare chief scientific advisor hai, unhone bola tha that the aim of this report is to create a sense of scientific social responsibility among the students. And guys, TFACS white paper had highlighted 5 thrust sectors which are major sectors if we want to boost our economy, which are healthcare, machinery, ICT, agriculture and manufacturing. So these 5 sectors we have to focus majorly. Okay, so that is about this news, and now let's come back to the question. So we have to tell which of the following sectors is not one of the focused sector in the TFACS white paper. So healthcare is there, machinery is there, ICT is there, manufacturing is there, while electronics, guys, is not there, which means option E will be the correct answer. Okay, so you have to remember the name of these 5 sectors on which we have to focus to boost our economy post COVID. All right. And now let's move on to question number 3, which is a very important question. It talks about a report that has been recently launched by UNESCAPE. Now you have to tell me the full form of this organization, UNESCAPE, write down in the comments. Consider the following statements regarding Asia Pacific trade and investment trends 2020-21 and identify the correct statement. So basically guys, this report talks about the FDI inflows and outflows. All right, FDI inflows or outflows ki baat karta hai ye. Okay, and it has been released by UN Escape, jiska full form aapko comment mein likh ke batana hai. So now let's talk about the global trend first. So this report says that at the end of the second quarter of 2020, jo FDI inflows hai, had decreased by 49% compared to the same period in 2019. Jo second quarter ke end tak 2020 ke jo hamara FDI inflow tha pure global, theek hai, global level ki baat kar rahe hain abhi, wo 49% drop ho gaya hai as compared to the same period for the year 2019. And Asia Pacific region's global share in FDI inflows also dropped from 45% in 2018 to 35% in 2019. Alright. While if you talk about the outflows, so the share of Asia Pacific region in the global outflows has been decreased from 52% to 41%. Alright. And China guys received the largest share, that is 23% of the greenfield FDIs FDI in 2019, followed by Vietnam, which is 11%, and then India, which is 10%. Okay. And talking about guys, South and Southwest Asia trends, jahan se hamara country bhi belong karta hai. So FDI inflows guys in this region dropped by just by 2%. Okay. From $67 billion in the year 2018 to $66 billion in 2019. So there was a drop of approximately 2% only. And India accounted for 77% inflows to the region, receiving $51 billion of FDI. जो ये region है South and Southwest Asia, इसमें India में 77% FDI inflow होता है, और जो total है that is how much, $51 billion का, okay? And the majority guys of FDI in India were in the field of ICT, information communication technology and construction sector. And second largest FDI recipient in this region is what, Turkey. India number one, then we have Turkey at the second place in the South and Southwest Asia trends. So we are not discussing about all the regions of Asia and Pacific. We are just discussing about this region from which India belong. Okay. In the first three quarters of 2020, greenfield FDI inflows dropped by 43% compared to the same period of the year 2019 in this region. And also most of the greenfield inflows were destined to India. That is how much? 87%. ज्यादातर ग्रीनफील्ड इनफ्लोस कहां पे थे? इस रीजन में, इंडिया में. कितने परसेंट? 87%. ओके, सो दैट इज अबाउट दिस न्यूज गाइज. एंड नाउ लेट्स मूव ऑन टू क्वेश्चन नंबर 3. सो यू हैव टू आइडेंटिफाई द करेक्ट स्टेटमेंट्स हियर. दिस रिपोर्ट हैज बीन रिलीज बाय यूएन इकोसॉक. नो, दैट इज नॉट यूएन इकोसॉक, दैट्स यूएन एस्केप. यूएन एस्केप, विच मीन्स दिस स्टेटमेंट इज इनकरेक्ट. ग्लोबल एफडीआई इनफ्लोज हैड ड्रॉप्ड बाय 59% एट द एंड ऑफ सेकंड क्वार्टर ऑफ 2020 as compared to the same period in 2019. So is that 59%? No, it's 49%, which means this statement is also incorrect. Asia Pacific region's FDI outflows global share had dropped from 52% in 2018 to 41% in 2019. Yes, this is absolutely correct. All right, this is absolutely correct. While if you talk about inflows, so inflows drop hue the from 45% to 35%, but this statement is about the outflows. So which was dropped from 52% to 41%, which means this statement is absolutely correct, and we have to identify the correct statements, which means option C, only 3 will be the correct answer here. Okay, and now let's move on to question number 4. So guys, question number 4 and 5 are based on this passage, and this passage is based on a scheme. So let's talk about this passage, and then we will move on to question number 4 and question number 5. So a scheme was launched by Ministry of Communications in 2017. So already we have two hints. One is the ministry, that is the Ministry of Communication. And then we have launch year, that is 2017. To promote philately as a hobby. Philately ko, yani ki collection of stamps ko, hobby ki tarah promote karne ke liye, this scheme was launched by the Ministry of Communication in 2017. So already guys, we have three most important hints in this passage. Okay. Under the scheme, government has decided to give 920 scholarships to the students based on their project and philately. Okay. So 920 scholarship government dega isme. Okay. And the scholarship is awarded based on the evaluation project work on philately. So guys, there is only one scheme which is related to philately, which is related to the collection of stamp as a hobby, and you have to identify that scheme. So I hope you can easily identify the scheme. Option A, Sparsh is the correct answer here. Deen Dayal Sparsh Yojana is the correct answer here. All right. So I hope, guys, you are able to identify this answer, this option. Option A, Sparsh is the correct answer. And this, अगर हम इसके बारे में और थोड़ा सा बात करें, so ये जो scholarship का amount है, that is how much? 6,000 per annum at the rate of 500 per month. 500 रुपए per month के हिसाब से scholarship दी जाती है based on the project work जो भी student ने prepare किया है. Okay. And question number 5, guys, is based on the eligibility of the same scheme which was mentioned in the passage which we have recently identified, Sparsh Yojana. So you have to identify the correct statement regarding eligibility. So let me tell you the eligibility of this scheme. So first, guys, you have to tell the answer. Let us see how many of you can answer this question. So you have to tell the answer of this question which talks about eligibility of this scheme Deen Dayal Sparsh Yojana, and you have to identify the correct statements. All right. So now let me tell you the eligibility. So from class 6 to 9 students are eligible. From class 6 to class 9 students are eligible. Then they have to score 60% in their recent final exam. Okay. And there is a, what is that called? Rebate. There is a rebate of 5% to SC or ST students. Okay. There is a rebate of how much? 5% to SC or ST students, SC or ST candidates to avail this scholarship. Alright, so these three are the eligibility criteria. And now let's talk about these statements. Students from class 6 to 12th are eligible to get the scholarship. So no, students from class 6 to 9th are eligible, which means this statement is incorrect. The student must have scored 60% in the recent final examinations. This is absolutely correct. And there is a relaxation of 10% in passing marks for SC or ST candidates. No, that is not 10%, guys. That is 5%, which means this statement is also incorrect. So we have only one statement correct here. That is option, statement number 2. Option C, only 2 will be the correct answer. All right. And guys, that's it for the session. And that was the last session of the year 2020. I hope agla saal will bring you a lot of happiness. Jo bhi aapko chahiye, wo aapko mile. And in tomorrow's session, that is on the very first session of the year 2021, we are going to discuss a very important topic, NFHS 5 Phase 1. Till then, enjoy the New Year's Eve. Goodbye, take care, and God bless.